again. Rusty Page here is host of WTVI's presentation of Cinema Classics, a showcase of 52 of the finest motion pictures ever made. Along with these vintage films, we've been exploring the role of Charlotte in the history of the film industry. Our feature this evening is The Scarlet Pimpernel, starring Leslie Howard in one of his finest performances, together with the exotic Merle Oberon and the versatile character actor Raymond Massey. This thrilling adventure of a master of disguises acting as a real pansy by day and as the savior of innocent French aristocracy by night. The story was written by Baroness Imuska Orz, an exiled Hungarian living in London. Upon hearing her landlord daughter's award-winning short story, Ms. Orz declared to her husband that she could write a better story, and she proceeded to do so. She said the idea for The Scarlet Pimpernel was born in a London underground where she saw a man whose appearance immediately suggested the role. She hurried home and started to write about his adventures with his faithful followers at the pace of 2 books per year. Her readers fed on the intrigue. The world of 1935 was still experiencing the Great Depression. News from Europe was unsettling as both Hitler and Mussolini flexed their military muscle. President Roosevelt hoped to allay some fears of the U.S. citizens by signing the Social Security Act. People flocked to see pictures reflecting the intrigue of the times. Versions of Anna Karenina, David Copperfield, Mutiny on the Bounty were all released that same year. And one of the theaters where people came to see such films was the Carolina Theater. Built by a local man, John Cutter, it was commissioned by Publix Theaters, who later became Paramount. The theater design was a collaboration of New York's R.E. Hall and Charlottean C.C. Hook. Hook had gained local notoriety about the turn of the century, designing homes in Charlotte's Dilworth section. And it was Charlotte's first streetcar suburb. Since movies covered all known time periods, the architects were able to draw from all historical styles. Publix suggested that since Charlotte was a southern city, they should go with perhaps a Mediterranean motif. The unusual design incorporated what looked like 4 quaint little buildings. Under the opulent exterior, commercial and office space was wrapped around outside the theater auditorium. No expense was spared, and the distinct Spanish flavor greeted the moviegoer at the quaintly designed wrought iron box office. From the main auditorium, the theater gained in splendor, approaching the grandeur of an old Spanish castle. A 1927 newspaper article read, quote, "Throughout the beautiful entrance lobbies, the great patio lobby, the foyers, the mezzanine passage, the lounge, and the restroom areas, everywhere were splendid examples of furniture in wrought iron, wood, and old leather. The principal entrance suggested a Venetian palace, while side details were Spanish, and the ceiling was Italian. The 1,200-seat palace opened on March 7, 1927, and was billed as, quote, the cathedral to entertainment. The management ran an ad in the newspaper the next day after the opening, apologizing for the standing room only crowd that had backed up into the palace to see Bebe Daniels in A Kiss in a Taxi, preceded by Faye Wilcox on the Wurlitzer organ, accompanied by what were billed as novelty slides. Going to the movies had become a once or maybe a twice a week habit for the entire family. You could hear babies crying and had kids running up and down the aisles. The Carolina Theater continued to be an institution of family entertainment until the advent of, you guessed it, television. And with that background, let's watch The Scarlet Pimpernel, a superbly mounted production featuring sets almost as lavish as the theaters in which it was shown. Let's take a look now, The Scarlet Pimpernel.